Good evening, guys. Okay. So to continue the story of this flux integral. Okay. So within this last meeting, we explained the meaning of flux. I tried. I think you kind of understood, right? Okay. That flux measures what?
Fluid,
flow. Like it's some flow of fluid, electricity, magnetism, and so on and so forth. So last meeting we had a surface. We said that if this is F and this is the normal vector N, I formed the parallelepiped, right, whose height was F dot N. F dot N is the height of the rectangular parallelepiped. That kind of represents the volume of the fluid flowing through this little differential of surface area, ds, okay? Now let's read this divergence theorem. What is the divergence theorem saying? So now we have Q is a region in three-dimensional coordinate system bounded by a closed surface S. So when we did 18.5, our surface was any floating surface, right? Okay? Now it has to be closed, okay? So if you have a closed surface S, so give me an example of a closed surface.
A sphere.
Yeah, a sphere is a good one, right? So in general, you have any, like something, okay, it's enclosed, okay? Let N be the unit outer normal to S at x, y, z. So let's say this is your x, y, z. Remember last meeting we talked about the unit outer normal and the unit inner, right? So we said that we assume our surfaces can be orientable or can be oriented. So we can talk of inside, outside, top, bottom, okay? What our book doesn't have is parametrization of surfaces. I know other books talk about, you know how this surface is like extension of curve, right? The inclined integral, we had oriented curves, right? We talked of orientation. So surface integrals, same thing. So Kowski first up, I don't think I missed it, right? I don't know. If you look at your books, I don't think we parameterize our surfaces. If we have time next meeting, maybe the last meeting, maybe I can talk about how to parameterize a surface. But loosely, I think what Sokowski did is just to say there's an orientation outward, inward, okay? So where was I? The x, y, z. If f is the vector function that has continuous first partial derivatives on q, notice those are usually the conditions, right? That the m and p should have continuous first partial derivatives. The divergence theorem says that flux integral of f over s is actually equal to the triple integral of the divergence of f. Divergence, right? The divergence of f, which is this notation also. It's the triple integral of div f over q. Alright? I don't know if anybody, it's too early for you to see if you can connect it with a theorem that we discussed a while ago. No? Maybe not. Okay, we'll tie all this up next meeting, okay? No, because right now, I guess you just want to copy, right? and see how to apply it. Yeah, first part of the class, let's just see how this works. Okay, so let's prove this. You want to see the proof, right?
Mm-hmm.
No?
Yeah.
Already application?
Yeah. What? No. Oh, yeah.
Any both?
Application.
Application?
Application.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Prove it.
Well, let's just show you the application first, and then maybe we can do the proof. Okay, just to apply this. Okay, application. Then we'll prove this one. Yeah, the proof is long. So yeah, okay. Just as since it's early, let's look at how it works. So you have f. Let's say is just number two y cubed into the z I minus x y j. Oh, actually, maybe after this application, somebody will say, oh, I remember that we did something similar before. Okay. Surface of the region. S is the surface of the region bounded by the coordinate planes. Okay. in the plane, x plus y plus z equals 1. Okay, what are we asked to do? I think we are asked to show, to use the divergence theorem. Could you guys read the instruction? I don't know why I don't write my instructions. What is the question there? Because we're going to illustrate this, okay? F dot and this. Well, maybe we'll figure out if we can find that.
So the same way we did it for
find the what? Find the flux integral F dot NDS using the divergence theorem, right?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Now the reason I'm not so sure is because, and anyway, I said I'll figure it out because the next section, the last section, Stokes theorem, we're asked to verify both sides will produce the same answer. But I said it's okay, I'll figure out if I can do both sides anyways. Okay, so first let's see, is our example okay with the theorem? We have a region in 3D, so maybe we should draw our surface, right? X, Y, Z, X plus Y plus Z equals 1 is the plane. So that's easy, right? This, 1, 1, 1. Sorry, it's not, you know what I mean, okay? Bounded by the coordinate planes, so are we good? Is the solid clear? Is it enclosed by a closed surface? It is, right? Okay, bounded by a closed surface S, correct? And denote the unit outer normal to S at X, Y, Z. So in general, you have a N here, right? F, X, Y, Z. If F is a vector function, then it's going to be blah, blah, blah. We want to compute the flux integral, all right? F dot NDS, using the divergence theorem. So on the test, if I say find this double integral over S or this flux integral using the divergence theorem, and you start doing what we did last meeting. What did we do last meeting? Last meeting, what we did was we said, well, this Z is equal to what? 1 minus X minus Y, right? What else did we do? Then we took the ZX, right? Is negative 1, ZY is negative 1. Are you on the right track if you're doing that? What are you actually doing there? You're finding the N, right? Okay. If you're finding the N and then you dot it with the F and then you integrate this, are you using the divergence theorem? Why not, Lily? Yeah, no, Lily said no, you're not. Yeah, if you start doing this and say, all right, then N is, but this is a good review of what happened last time, right? So last time we said, what was N? What was N? Isn't it the negative of these, right?
Yeah.
Correct? 1, 1, and then the K was 1, right? Right? Okay. All over what?
Square root of.
The square root of this square, right? So 1, 2 square, 1 square.
Also, we don't want to take Z sub X and Z sub Y.
I mean, this was okay, but what are you, the motion you're going through is what? Then you want to do F dot N, right?
Yeah.
DS, correct? Okay. Then you get the dot product of this with the F, and then you turn in your paper. Is that correct? Did you give me the correct solution?
No.
No, because what you did here was you calculated this, right? So well and good, you calculated this using that. All you did was direct calculation, right? What did you miss? But I said I don't want you to calculate it directly. I want you to calculate it using the divergence theorem. What does that mean? So don't do this, right? So don't do this. I'm happy you know how to do this, okay? But if you want to use the divergence theorem, what does the divergence theorem tell you? Rather than doing that, you really need to take the triple integral over Q of the divergence of F dV. Alright? So this is what you have to do. You understand? Alright? So how does that work? So we need to get div F. Actually, I heard something wrong with my notation, which I did okay here. I always have to put the what? The dot, right? Without the dot, del F, big F doesn't mean anything, right? Correct? Okay. So I need to do del dot F. What is that? What does that mean? Del dot F is just what? It's just partial with respect to X, comma, partial with respect to Y, partial with respect to Z, dotted with what? The M, which is Y cubed, E to the Z, right? Minus XY, and the X are 10Y. You remember this? In short, the div is really just the partial of each of these with respect to X, with respect to Y, with respect to Z, right? In that order. So that's going to be what? With respect to X, the first one is 0. With respect to Y, the second one is negative X. And with respect to Z, the second one is, the third one is 0. So the answer here is negative X. Okay? So therefore, moving... Oh, yeah, and then I think that's it, right? So then all we have to do now to get the flux integral is to get negative x dv. And now all you have to do is chapter 17, right? What do I mean by chapter 17? You just have to take care of your volume, right? Okay? Your volume and decide how you want to go about it. How do you want to go about it? Do you want to walk on the floor?
DZ, DY, DX.
Do you want to do DZ, DY, DX? Let's try that, okay? So let's do... Okay, according to Anthony, let's do DZ, DY, DX, okay? So if that's DZ, DY, DX, that means to say you're first going from floor to the ceiling, in this case is the plane, right? Okay? Floor to ceiling, so that's going to be what?
Zero to
z equals zero, let's put the z here, z zero to z equals one minus x minus one. So you're now going like that, okay? And then according to Anthony, let's do dy first. So y first will go from where? From zero to, what is this equation here?
One minus
y equals one minus x, right? Okay, is that right? Yeah. So y equals 0, y equals 1 minus x. And finally, your x will just run from
0 to 1.
0 to 1. Is that clear? Okay. And so, yeah, I guess you know how to do that, right? So the answer you get should be negative 1 over 24. Did you guys understand the divergence theorem? So it's very easy, right? If you understand it, that's all you have to do. So, but maybe you should prove a little bit?
Yeah, prove it.
All right, so now let's prove it. It's just to remember what we did last time. Okay, so for the proof. Again, I'm sorry, I still cannot decide which notation I like. So I keep going back and forth between the IJK and the pointy. Okay? So we want to show that the double integral over S okay, wait a minute. So did you understand where this came from? Yeah, because remember, this side is really the flux integral, right? This side is the flux integral. If F is MI plus NJ plus PK, don't you just get the dot product of F? So each component, so MI dotted with N, NJ dotted with N, PK dotted with N. So that's that left side, all right? Is equal to the triple integral over Q of div, and you already saw how to get div. What is that? It's partial, right? Okay? So div is partial m with respect to x plus partial n with respect to y plus partial of p with respect to z. Right? DV. Did I not do it right? Isn't it? That's the meaning of the... So this is really the right side of the divergence theorem. DV. Okay? So let's show that. And take a guess. The good news is what? Here there are three terms. There are three. So what do you think we'll do? We've done something like this before. I don't know if you remember what theorem that was. It suffices to show what? What do you think? The first one is double integral over S of mi dot n ds. Take a guess. Should equal to what? There are three of them up there. There are three of them down here. What do you think it's enough to show? One, two, three. By terms, right? Okay, so it's enough to show that corresponding term, I don't know how to say that, okay, that is going to be the triple integral over Q of partial of M with respect to X dV, okay? The next one is double integral over S of NJ dot N dS is the triple integral over Q of what? Partial of N with respect to Y dV. And then you have P K dot N, okay, ds is going to be the triple integral of the last one. And because they are all similar, it suffices to show what? One of them, and we can just argue similarly, right? Question, Anthony.
How do we go from the double integral of the surface to the triple integral of the...
That's what we're trying to prove. To show. This is what we're trying to establish. Okay. Remember, we're trying to establish the divergence theorem, which is double to triple, right? Okay? So we're kind of telling ourselves, what is it that we want to show? So those of you who will be math people will say, how do we show this? Well, then you have to show that this, so basically you spelled it out. Okay. What is the meaning of f dot nds? How will div f dv look like? You understand? And then if you look at the form, I guess I'm just following how Sokowski proved it, okay, and others before him, okay? It looks like it suffices to show that it's like I grab them component by component, right? Okay? Now, these three kind of all look similar, right? Which of them do you think is the easiest to show? It's something about what we talked about last meeting. Remember when we were talking of surface integrals, the surface could be hovering over the floor, or it could be facing your yz plane, right? Or it could be facing your xz plane. You remember that? Which do you think is easier, easiest? Our usual way of looking is what?
Over the x.
Our usual way of looking is over the x, right? Over the xy. Which of these three guys do you think will do that? I'm thinking number three, right? Okay, isn't it? How did you guess that it's probably number three that's easiest to show? How did you know that that's the one that's hovering over the floor? Well, no, I put the check mark after you told me let's do number three. What did you see?
Z is not like x, y, that's not an easy number.
Huh?
The z is not part of the x, y plane.
Anybody else? What? I don't know.
It's a good guess. I thought it was brilliant.
Okay, while I'm writing this, maybe some of you would want to think of it. I know you guys are tired, right? It's almost final exam week.
Oh my God, don't remind me.
Don't remind you. Okay, what am I drawing here? Wait, let me change the colors. Guys, did anybody figure out why 3 is the one that's the picture, that drawing is this scenario?
This is the third part that you get from the other two, from the other two articles.
What? Help with Leo, what? Why is the third the one we pick to
when you multiply good, that one's good.
And I'm saying if you can draw this picture.
You have a change in a potential function of P, or part of a potential function of P with respect to Z, so your Z is going to go from whatever to whatever, so your Z is the one that's changing.
Mm-hmm. The triple integral, the Z is going to be the first of the changes. So
are you looking at the triple integral, right?
Yeah.
I think I'm looking more at the K. Anyway, let's see. Let's claim that this is what we have, right? Okay, now, what picture do I have here? Do I have the picture of divergence theorem? I need this. I need it to be a closed surface, right? Okay, so the way the proof works is, assume that this closed surface would look like a surface on top, a surface below, and a surface around. All right? The way we did it last meeting for the flux integral was what? For the flux integral, what we did was we chose a
normal
here, normal there, right? Isn't it? For each surface, you choose a normal. And in fact, I think we had a problem similar to this, Nick. Remember that? Where, because it's kind of like, what you call this, perpendicular to the region. What will be the, what you call this? What will be the k component of the normal vector here? Is zero, right? This is your r, x, y.
On the bar.
You remember that?
Y is zero.
So we have s1, s2, s3. Let me call surface s1, z equals u of x, y. Let me call surface s2, z equals v of x, y, and we claim that actually we don't care for S3, which is the surrounding. Why is it that we don't care for S3? Well, remember the normal component will have ijk, right, component, okay? Well, on S3, what is the k component? I guess I have to explain that this is like standing like that, right? So the k component is zero, okay? So if the k component is zero, what am I saying here? I really want to look at the surface integral pk dot n ds, right? But my s, the closed surface, consists of what? S1, right? Pk dot n ds plus what? S2 pk dot n ds plus S3 pk dot n ds. Okay? And because somebody here will disappear because of that, the k component on S3 is zero, so we can actually just forget this. Right? Okay? Because notice, why is it that it's only the k I'm looking at? Because the ij component is gone here, right? So when you're doing the dot, you're really just dotting, I mean multiplying the k component with the k component of your n. Alright? This has no ij, and so on and so forth. Okay. Are you okay? You understand what I said? Alright? Okay. Let us, then the reason I wanted to prove this is now let's go back to the S1. How did we find our normal vector to S1? What did we do? So on S1, we got our normal vector. How? What did we do? It's negative ZX, right? Negative ZY 1, correct? Over the square root of ZX squared plus ZY squared plus 1, right? Wasn't that our normal vector? Okay, so and then in terms of U, that's going to be UX at XY, right? Sorry, I keep dropping that. You evaluate it at the point. Okay, now what do I want? I want pk dot n. So if I do pk dot n, what happens? Who will survive?
Of the region 1?
Mm-hmm. And in S1.
all of them except for the...
Well, if you have k dot n first without the p, what's k dot n?
Okay.
Isn't k dot n 0, 0, 1 dotted with that, right? Who will survive?
1 over.
Just a 1, right? 1 over zx squared plus zy squared plus 1. Get it? Okay. So if we look here at this first one, k dot n is 1 over this, multiply that by p, right? Remember what does ds have that will make it look nice? This will become what? This is going to look like p over what? Square root of this, right?
Oh yeah, that's right, because it's got the...
And then remember why I was so happy with this? I said, don't worry about that, because what does ds have? The ds have that same thing, right? Okay? And that's dA. You agree? So then you have this that cancels, so you have that. Are you following? So that's the story for... pk dot n ds. Alright, for the first one. So done with the first one. Now for the second one, what's going to happen? What kind of normal vector are you going to produce here for S2? Sorry guys, it's too far.
See with respect to S2.
Remember, we talked of upper normal and lower normal. So now if it's lower normal, what will happen?
The signs change.
The signs will change, right? So now it's going to be, let's not use z because they're both called z. So it will be what? Vx, right? Vy, and negative 1, right? Okay? Over the square root of vx squared plus vy squared plus 1. Are you okay? Right? So that is, sorry, that's your n or negative n. Okay, I don't know if I should use n or negative. I just keep it as n. But because it's pointing downwards, it will look like this. Okay, now what do I want to do again? I want to dot that with n, right? With k, rather. So what is k dot n? Who's the only one that will survive? The negative 1 over this, right? Vx squared vy squared plus 1. All right? So now if we plop that here, p times k dot n, what will I get?
Negative p.
I'll get a minus, right? Correct? I'll get a minus integral over S2 of 1 of p, right? Okay? And then, yeah, you know there will be a square root that will cancel with the square root, right? dA. So far you're okay, right? So you have that. Let's see. So where am I now? I need to somehow miraculously put that as a double integral. Okay, yeah. When we cancel, once we change to A, there's something wrong with my notation now, right? Can somebody help me fix that notation? Instead of calling them not R1 and R2, but it's just what? How many R's? How many do they project? These surfaces both projected only to R, right? Okay. So this actually should not be S1 anymore because now this is dA already. You're just referring to the region. So this is RXY, and this is, well, let's keep it as S2. Instead of S2, this should be RXY, okay? So it looks like actually I have a double integral minus another double integral over the same region. So can I put those two together? Right? So I can put those two together over the same region RXY, and let's see, how will we need to kind of spell out, yeah, these p's are really different, right? The p, this p here was evaluated where? At a point on S1, right? Okay, so this is really p evaluated at XY. What was the z? Was the u of XY, is that right? Okay, that's the top one, right? Minus the other p was really evaluated at xy and v of xy. Is that correct? All right? Sorry, guys, I'm too far away. Okay? dA. But doesn't this look like what? This can be written as, you see the triple integral?
Okay.
this is like the difference of the p's, right? So it's like what? Let's see, wait, I need to produce the partial. Yeah, let's look at the result we want to get. I need to, does that look like a partial of p with respect to z? Yeah, I think so, right? This is like the change, see how, who changed here? Just the z's, correct? The z's were the ones that changed. So this looks like partial of p with respect to z. How do I do that? Let me, it's, but so far, you're okay, right? This integrated from v of xy to u of xy dz. Yes, I think that's it. Because when you integrate the partial of p with respect to z dz, don't you get p?
Mm-hmm.
Correct? You get p of xyz, and then your p of xyz, you evaluate lower to upper, you get this. Correct? Okay? But what is this? Isn't this now the triple integral over the solid Q, partial of p with respect to z, dz? And I think that's what I have, right? Oh wait, sorry, and then dA. I keep forgetting to copy. There's a dA, which will be your, together dz and dA will be what?
dV.
Your dV. Okay? I don't know if you understood that, but that's kind of how you prove three. And similarly, if you want to prove one or two, then you'll have to have your surface, closed surface, facing either this wall or that wall. But I think this one was easier to see. Any part of the proof you're interested in going over or what? The reason, I think the advantage of the proof was that we kind of got to review how we did our normal vectors. That's the only thing I can see. Okay? And then, yeah, I kind of struggled with how to show this, but yeah, then you have the integral of the partial. All right.
Professor,
question.
Can you repeat the last part after you
repeat
cancel?
The last part? Let's see. Which one? Which part?
After you cancel the radicals and then you put them together.
Remember from last meeting, this one here is your ds, right?
Yes. Yeah,
oh yeah,
part.
You understood that
yeah,
part.
After that.
Then you put them together. These really are evaluated at points, right? X, Y, Z, right? Where the point here, the p here, the value of p here depends on what your xyz is on S1, correct? The top, because it says S1, right? This one is S2, so that's p. The p here is not a point, it's the p is the third function, right? Remember, I know it's unfortunate they use p. It's mnp, okay, it's the third function. Yeah, it's not a point, it's the third function, it's the kth component of your f, all right? So then we said, well, but that really means the p at the first surface, right? The third function evaluated at the x, y, z of the first surface, the top surface, minus the p function, right? Evaluated at the x, y, z of the bottom surface, all right? So this one. But this looks like a function evaluated from some value of z to another value of z, right? So we said, yeah, this was where it was kind of hard to explain. From here to here, this is really, the way to look at this is the integral of the partial. Remember, when you integrate the partial, you get the p, right? Correct? The integral of the partial dz is p, evaluated from z equals v to z equals u. Okay, so that's what you have there. And then, yeah, just keep remembering to plop your dA, and there you go, there's your dV. You understand? All right? Do we need another example, or at this point, is this ringing a bell? Did you see something similar to this a while ago? Like some integral became more, so this is a double integral becoming a triple integral. Did we see something before that was kind of similar to this? Who? Tyler? Yeah, remember Green's theorem?
Yes.
And next meeting, I won't do it to you today. Next meeting, we have a week to tie all these up, right? Okay?
We have a week to study.
We have a day.
A week?
To study.
No, to study. And then we meet, when we meet next Thursday, hopefully we're all prepared to put all the pieces together. Okay? Because then that's our final exam. Does anybody remember what Green's theorem said? Anybody for Green's theorem? It was a line integral, right? Over a curve. See, what kind of curve did we want for Green's theorem? Simple, but not just that. Also piecewise smooth, and it has to be... You see that? It has to be closed. Somebody asked me, I forget, was it Adnan? Somebody asked me, sometimes the books put arrows.
Yeah, they do.
The arrow just means what? We said usually we traverse it in the counterclockwise direction is positive. What did Green's theorem say? Do you remember? F. There's always that F. Dot. T. Is it T? D. So yeah, these are the things we need to figure out. R, S, A, W.
DS,
right?
Yeah.
F,
yes, yes.
Isn't it? And it's little s, okay? Some books actually use a different letter for surface area because it's kind of confusing. You have to point out, this is arc length. And an application of this is work, of course, right? Okay? Force applied to this in the direction of the tangent times a little change in the arc length. What did Green say this was? Line integral became what?
Double
integral, right? Over what?
Region.
A region, right? The region that is being enclosed by your C. Correct? Okay. Of what? Do you guys remember the expression?
Curl
F. Curl F dot K, right? DA. And those of, and the curl actually it had another way of being represented. It was partial of what? And I know you said, will I remember all this for final exam? I think it was something like this, right? Okay. So Green's theorem, in a way, you can think of Green's theorem as a special case. It's kind of like Stokes' theorem, right? Except it's flat on the plane, right? And Stoke, or you can say Stoke, actually Green was, Stoke got his idea, actually Stoke's theorem, oh no, why am I saying Stoke? I'm doing divergence. I mean, I know because Stoke's theorem is also a generalization of Green's. I told you, I read so many things today that everything is now jumbled in my head. Rewind. I'm talking of the divergence theorem, and do you guys see the analogy between divergence theorem and Green's theorem? How? This one went from 1 to 2, right? Divergence went from 2 to 3. This one had to use a closed curve, right? Divergence had to use what? A closed surface. So you cannot really apply the divergence theorem if you just have a floating surface. You understand? It has to be a closed surface. I think, yeah, and then... Like I said, next meeting, let's talk some more about physics, how to tie up all these things, blah, blah, blah.